I was just asking myself, how many times do I usually acknowledge God? How many times am I usually bold enough to say, oh, baby, I'm a Christian. And yeah, and I love Jesus. And you've been doing your Wordmas, and yeah, I know I've been lagging behind a bit in posting the the verses daily, or the summaries of the verses daily, but I have been reading them. I've just been lacking time to just do the summary, but I'm here for chapter 11 and 12. I hope you read it. I hope you God spoke to you as an individual, you know, and I hope you learned something. If you've not read after watching this video, maybe you can consider reading chapter 11 and 12, or even just reading the book of Luke from the beginning. It will be good to read from the beginning to the end. So I'll just go right into the summary of chapter 11, in Luke chapter 11. So chapter 11 starts with the Lord's Prayer. We all know the Lord's Prayer. If you are a Christian, to some extent you've learned about the Lord's Prayer. We start with our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, or your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. So this one came after the disciples of Jesus asked Jesus to teach them how to pray. So that's the prayer he taught them how to pray. And sometimes I know there has been, you know, a push and pull concerning, should we just pray like this, or can we also like come up with words that are personal and pray to God? And I'm here to tell us that, yeah, we can still pray to God using other words, as long as we do, you know, we acknowledge God as the Father, as long as we repent our sins, as long as we acknowledge Him as the provider. Yeah, and as long as we pray for forgiveness. So apart from that, Jesus is just urging us to continue, just down there in the same chapter, to continue seeking, to continue knocking, you know, to continue asking. And he says, after saying that, he says, seek and you shall find, knock and the door will open to you, ask and it shall be given to you. And after that, he says, if our earthly fathers who are evil know how to give good gifts to their children, how much more will our Father who is in heaven give us the Holy Spirit, if you ask Him? So it's just, you know, comparing our earthly fathers and the way they're usually keen to give us what we ask for. They never give us like a serpent when you ask for fish, you know, or any other thing when you ask for a different thing. How much more if we ask for the Holy Spirit, whom we need each and every day, can God give us, is able to give us? You know, if you're hungry for God to fill you with Holy Spirit, He's able to do that. So that's the emphasis there. It's all about just praying and, you know, doing it consistently and just going on doing it. It's not about, you know, when you seek for something, you don't actually, another verse says continue seeking, continue knocking, continue asking. These are things that you have to do over and over. And I know sometimes people say, I pray, but I don't get answers. If you're asking God for something, maybe it's a sick person, continue doing it and God will answer you ultimately. So apart from that, there is much more that we see still Jesus continue doing, and he continues condemning hypocrisy. Jesus was big about hypocrisy. Like, he didn't like hypocrisy at all. And if he just condemns the Pharisees for being hypocrites and ignoring injustice and the love of God and emphasizing on laws, like people should do this or that. And in this chapter, he just condemns that. And then the other thing is about the return of the unclean spirit. It was the evil spirit that Jesus was saying, the way when you cast out an evil spirit, if it goes away and it finds that person has not embraced or has not been filled by the Holy Spirit, it comes back, but it doesn't come back alone. It comes back with even more powerful, evil spirit, and the person get even more possessed. Like, there was that exchange that took place whereby you are no longer the son of the devil and you became the son of God upon the day when you received the Holy Spirit. I mean, upon the day when you got born again and, of course, consequently received the Holy Spirit. So if you're not keen to go hard on the things of God and allow God to fill you with His Spirit, it is possible that the evil spirit may come. And if you're not vigilant in prayer, vigilant in the Word, you're not vigilant in the things of God, He may come with others and attack you. That was my understanding. And sometimes you usually see people like getting born again, and then after a short while, if they are not keen with the things of God, if they don't go hard on them, they fall, but they don't fall to the level where they were. They like fall under. And I think for me, that was my understanding. That was my understanding that if you want to go for the things of God, go for them hard enough. Like, be vigilant. Be vigilant in prayer. Be vigilant in fasting, in seeking God and wanting Him to fill you with His Spirit each and every day, because the devil is not asleep. Guys, the devil is not asleep. He's always looking for us. He's always looking to take over us, take over our hearts and our lives and bring confusion. So in chapter 12, it's talking about fear. And when I look at this, we're told not to fear Him who can only destroy the body but cannot destroy the soul. And I think for me, the first is man. And sometimes you're so scared of men. I think our greatest fear comes from the fear of man, because you're always scared of what people will think about us. When you want to do something, you're like, what will people think of me? What will people say? Will they find me still cool? And for me, like, even just being here and speaking about God, you know, I might be afraid that, so if I share maybe my link with my friend and they're like, oh, so what is your YouTube about? And I'll be like, oh, so I do some Christian talk here and there. Sometimes I do this and that. But mostly it's about, Christianity. And then my friends may be like, oh, so that's not cool. Okay. Or okay. And they mean, oh, that's not cool. But you should still do what God called you to do, despite people's opinion, because I tend to feel that man's biggest source of fear is another man. Like, we fear people, and may God help us to go hard on what He wants us to do, regardless of what people may think about us. That we should not be afraid of people. We should not be afraid of being cut off. Like, people just dissociating from you simply because you're doing the will of God. Actually, in this chapter, God speaks a lot about just acknowledging Him and our attitude towards God and things. So the other thing is just talking about, if we do not acknowledge God on earth, He too will not acknowledge us in heaven. And I was just asking myself, how many times do I usually acknowledge God? How many times am I usually bold enough to say, oh, baby, I'm a Christian, and yeah, and I love Jesus, and I believe in all these things about Jesus, and yeah, I'm living according to the Bible standards, or I really try to. Jesus is just saying that if you do not acknowledge me on earth, I too will not acknowledge you in heaven. And another way of just acknowledging Jesus is giving your life to Christ, because sometimes we feel that giving our lives to Christ will limit us of what the world has for us. But we forget that in this world, we will just live for a limited time. That after your 90 years, your 70 years, you will go to heaven and live forever. And forever means forever, like life without an end. So if you don't acknowledge Jesus within your 90 years, when you go to heaven and you live forever, forever is not a thousand years. What about that? If He doesn't acknowledge you and you are 1,000 years, you have to live in hell. Don't you think that it's wise to live the 90 years according to God's will, then live the 1,000 years in the presence of God? And when we compare that life with this life we have on earth, I hope that we will remember actually this life on earth and we'll be like, oh my God, I wish I knew. So apart from that, you see the parable of the rich fool. And then this parable usually amazes me. There was just this young man who, I don't know whether he was young. Was he young? I don't know. But he was rich and foolish. So this man, got a big harvest. And then he said to himself, I will get a big barn, you know, a big place to put my harvest. And then I will just have a good time. I will tell my soul, eat, drink, you know, make merry. And Jesus tells him, it was actually a parable, but Jesus say, your soul is required of you. Like today is your last day. You will actually not enjoy the way you think. Today you're going to die. So this parable is told for us to realize how life is short. We have so many plans as men. We say that tomorrow I'll do this, tomorrow I'll do that. But we really don't know how much we live. And sometimes we make boastful, prideful plans that are not in line with God's will. And we don't even mind to ask God, God, what would you want me to do? What would you want me to do with my big harvest? What would you want me to do with my promotion? What would you want me to do with my bonus? You know, what would you want me to do with my extra time? We think of how we can use that time, yet we don't know how short life is. So I think in this place also God condemns materialism and he wants us to have an eternal perspective. As you look at life, look at it with eternity in mind. Look at it and think, like, if today was my last day, would I still go to heaven? Did he think of heaven? Did he think of other things? And apart from that, we are told not to be anxious. We're told not to be anxious about anything. That's just down there after that parable. We're told not to be anxious of what to wear. We're told not to be anxious of what to eat. Because God already provides for the birds. And it's not like we should not even make an effort to provide for ourselves or to earn a living through working hard and all that. But we're just told not to be too anxious. Think that we have matters on our own hands. Like, God is in control. He is our provider ultimately. You know, he even provided for us when we were in our mother's womb. He ensured that the nutrients that our parents were taking were going directly to us, and we grew to that point. He's still able to provide for us on earth. It's not like simply because we can work, so we cannot rely on God. We should. So I think there we're just being reminded that you should not be anxious about all these things, because God is able to provide for us. So the other thing that Jesus speaks about in Luke chapter 12 is readiness. That it gives, I think, is it a parable? I don't know whether it's a parable. Or it just give an example of if a person is waiting for his master who went for a wedding feast. And you know, like, it's like a gatekeeper, for example, waiting for the master who's out there, and he needs to open for him. He will be alert. So he compares us to that gatekeeper who's waiting for the master who is out there, and is waiting to open the door for him. And he says that we should be alert. As Christians, we ought to be alert, because, you know, Jesus will come at any time. And I look at this chapter 12 of the book of Luke, as a reminder that we should be ready. We should be very ready for the coming of Christ. And then we should not have materialism at the center of our hearts. That deep within our hearts, God should take the center. God should be the center of our lives and not materialism. And then the other thing that Jesus just speak about is just acknowledging him while we are on earth, that we should not be ashamed of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is our Savior. We should not be ashamed to proclaim that Jesus is our Savior. So I see those three things being the major things that is being spoken about here. And I hope we will just think about those things. We will ask ourselves the hard questions. Am I ashamed of Jesus Christ? Am I so materialistic to a point that I do not realize that Jesus is in charge, is able to provide for me, that my resources belongs to him? And the third one is, am I ready? Am I ensuring that I'm ready for his coming? Because Jesus is coming soon and very soon. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you'll continue reading. I hope you will challenge yourself. You'll take notes. You will ask yourself hard questions. And you know, we will continue building each other in faith and in love, and you know, as we wait for the coming of Jesus Christ. Amen. So if you're watching this and you've not subscribed to this channel, kindly consider subscribing. Also leave a comment down below of what you understood from the book of Luke chapter 11 and 12. Let me know your experience as you read the book of Luke, or any other thing that you might be reading during this pre-Christmas time. Yeah, and apart from that, I just want to tell you that I'm so grateful that you always come here and watch my videos. God bless you so much. Bye.